Hi there, this is Paula from Replicon. Here at Replicon, timesheets are at the core of our business. So as you might imagine, we offer a multitude of options for configuring timesheets to meet a broad range of usage scenarios. This means there are a lot of settings for an administrator to understand when setting up a timesheet system. My goal with this video is to give you an overview of the available settings to help make the setup process a little bit easier. I'll cover setting up timesheet items to assign to users, configuring system settings, creating timesheet templates, and assigning timesheet settings to users. Many timesheet settings are assigned directly to users in their user profiles, meaning you have a great deal of flexibility in how you assign them. These are the key items that will later be assigned directly to users. Timesheet templates are the most critical item, since they determine how the user's timesheet looks and acts. I'll focus on how timesheet templates work later in this video. Timesheet periods determine the length of a timesheet. For example, weekly, biweekly, or monthly. There's also a weekly end of month option, where weeks flex in length so they end at the end of each month. Note you can create a system timesheet period or ones that apply to only a particular employee type or department. Timesheet approval paths determine who approves a user's timesheets, and if there are multiple approvers, the order of approval. See our Setting Up Approvals video or help topic for more information on how approvals work. You can allow or require users to enter time against activities. Activities can be used in place of, or in addition to, projects and tasks. You might also want to ensure timesheet email and push notifications are set. These can remind users to fill out their timesheets or notify them that timesheets have been approved or rejected. There are also notifications aimed at supervisors and timesheet approvers that you might want to configure. Finally, you might need to configure timesheet-related permissions for supervisors and other managers. For example, you can modify approval options or whether supervisors are able to submit or reopen their reports timesheets. There are a couple of system settings that apply to all users. That is, unlike the settings I just talked about, they are not assigned in user profiles. The first is timesheet due and end dates, which are set by clicking timesheet settings. Due dates determine when timesheets and their approvals are due, relative to the end of a timesheet period. So you could set timesheets to be due on the last day of the period, and approvals to be due 2 days later. While end dates determine how far in advance time can be entered in timesheets. The other system option is break types. These are the types of breaks in, out, and punch users can select in their timesheets. So you might need to configure these if your employees use those timesheet formats. Finally, depending on what you're using timesheet data for, you may have to configure some timesheet settings to meet your purposes. For example, if you use timesheet data to generate payroll, you'll need to create pay codes like regular time and time and a half and assign pay rates to users. You'll also need to set up pay rules, which determine how users are paid under different circumstances. Or, if you're using timesheet data for invoicing clients, you'll have to set up clients, projects, and billing rates so employees can enter their time against the applicable projects and generate billing data. An employee has to be a member of a project team for that project to be available in their timesheet. Timesheet templates are the single most important item you'll need to set up when configuring your system for timesheet use. Timesheet templates include many options that determine how timesheets look and function. There are four categories to configure in a timesheet template: permissions, timesheet UI, validations, and workflow conditions. Permissions act just like permissions assigned in user profiles, except these permissions are related to the timesheet. For example, permissions can allow the employee to reopen submitted timesheets or can make timesheets auto-submit on their due date. The timesheet UI category determines the timesheet's format. As you can see, there are a lot of components to choose from. To break them down, four of these components are the basic timesheet formats. You'll need to select one of these for a user to record time. With the in-out times format, employees record their start and stop times, but not in real time. The in-out times plus allocation format allows users to allocate the in-out hours they record to projects and activities. You'll need to assign the time punches format if you're using our time punches system for recording exact in and out times. Finally, employees use the time distribution grid format to enter work durations against projects or activities if applicable. Note that an in-out or punch format is most commonly used in payroll systems, while all formats with the exception of the basic in-out format can be used to record time against projects for costing or billing purposes. The rest of the timesheet UI options are timesheet add-ons, not used for recording time. There are the daily fields and timesheet fields that are both used to add custom fields to a timesheet. Approval history, payroll summary, schedule, target billable hours, and time comments all add information to the timesheet for users to view. Target billable hours shows a graph of user or team progress toward billing goals, and time comments is typically used by timesheet approvers so they can view comments without having to click each cell. Notice and attestation are both message fields. Notice displays a custom message on the timesheet. For example, a notice could state, "All timesheets are due by 4 p.m. An attestation, on the other hand, allows or requires the user to agree to a statement by checking a box on their timesheet. For example, the statement could read, "I agree that the data entered is accurate." And finally, there are two time-off components. The time-off bookings component displays a list of bookings on the timesheet, and the time-off in lieu component is required if employees are allowed to take time off in lieu of overtime. Note that some of these options may not be available in your system depending on what products you're using. Once you've chosen one or more UI components, you can assign any validations. Validations help ensure data entered is complete and accurate by imposing limits on what can be entered. Popular validations include daily minimum hours that requires employees to enter a daily minimum, say 8 hours each day, and mandatory custom fields that requires employees to complete certain custom fields. But as you can see, there are many other validation rules available to meet many requirements. Note that many of the validation rules have configurable parameters. You can edit those parameters by clicking Timesheet Validation Rules on the administration page. Finally, you can set workflow conditions. These options mainly relate to when employees can submit timesheets. For example, the Errors Prevent Submission option is a popular one, as it prevents employees from submitting their timesheet if it includes a validation error, say if the employee failed to include 8 hours on one day of the timesheet. What constitutes a validation error is defined by the validation rules I showed you a moment ago. Before saving the template, you can choose to set an autofill option, which will autofill each new timesheet with data like the previous week's time or the employee's scheduled hours. You can edit the parameters of these options, like whether or not existing data should be overwritten, by selecting timesheet population methods from the administration page. Note that any methods enabled will be available on the timesheet for employees to use on an ad hoc basis. Now all that's left is to assign everything you've configured to users in their user profiles. Typically, you'll need to assign supervisors a license that gives them timesheet features, a permission profile that allows them to manage timesheets, and timesheet notifications. So, for example, they are alerted when timesheets are ready to approve. Then you can assign settings to end users. On the Timesheet tab, assign the appropriate timesheet template, a timesheet period, which is often the system period, a timesheet approval path, and, if applicable, select the activities the employee can enter time against. Then, make sure they have a license that grants them timesheet functionality, and assign them timesheet notifications, so they receive notices when their timesheets are due or overdue, as an example. And finally, enable any other settings needed for your specific purposes, such as assigning them a pay rate and pay rule on the payroll tab. Remember that you can mass edit existing users to make this setup process easier, or you can use our RIA import tool to add multiple users and their appropriate settings in a single step. That's about it for configuring timesheets in Replicon. For more information on RIA or for a checklist of the timesheet setup steps, visit www.replicon.com/help. That's all from me for now. Thanks for your time.